kind of a mixed bag of weather around the country on this Friday afternoon. We've got that system from the Gulf of Mexico moving inland. The center of it is over Alabama, and a large precipitation area that did produce some flooding rains in parts of the U.S., especially in Florida. If we switch over to the surface map, we can see that there's not too much of a reflection of that weather system, just some evidence of troughing in Mississippi and Alabama, but we can certainly see the precipitation field and the much cooler temperatures down in the lower 60s in northern South Carolina. At the larger scale, we do have the southerly return flow starting up. This pattern resembles the Bermuda High. That's high pressure off to the right, and with that, we're starting to get that onshore flow setting in once again in the western Gulf, and with that, the appearance of a dry line in western Kansas down along the caprock. Before we get into details, let's take a quick look at the northeast. The satellite view in the northeast does show snow and ice still on the ground in Quebec and Ontario, but looks are deceiving. Yesterday, Burlington, Vermont got up to 88 degrees, and today, Albany coming up to 85, and I saw 90 degree readings in Massachusetts. But down to the south, we've got that cutoff low moving north, and that is going to spread some clouds and moisture into that part of the country. We have had this polar front sag to the south through New England, and that's brought the temperatures down in Burlington and out towards Ontario. But down to the south, still got that warm air mass in place and that area of disturbed weather coming up from the south. And there's the temperatures at this hour as we record this early afternoon, 90s around Springfield, Hartford, and back towards Providence. And further out to the west, lots of 80s, all the way back towards Buffalo. The southeastern U.S. in between this Bermuda High and this troughing out there in West Texas. And that puts the region under a general southerly flow, broken up, of course, by that upper level low heading to the north. Yesterday, some major flooding out around Fort Lauderdale. Let's take a look at the rainfall. Here's a look at the 7-day radar-derived precipitation totals. You can see that bullseye there north of Miami. Let's zoom in for a closer look. And there it is, Miami, Fort Lauderdale, and that bullseye, the white color indicating 20 inches of estimated precipitation. We go back to the pre-dawn hours on Wednesday. Frontal system out there in the Gulf that we talked about on the Wednesday show, plenty of moisture and instability. And then running that forward, large MCS developing across the southern part of Florida. This is going to be about noon. So large MCS up there in the Fort Lauderdale area. And you can see a couple of cells really get anchored right there along the coast. So we're up to about 1 or 2 p.m. And as we keep going forward, very persistent cell right there around Fort Lauderdale. Now we're up to the evening hours, still coming down, and finally around 10 p.m. that cell gives up. So that was kind of a freak occurrence. We go into Wednesday night into Thursday, a little bit of a break, but things regenerate. This is going to be during the morning. There they go. Things lighting up once again. Additional precip, not what they need, but there it is. And finally, as the system lifts to the north, a break overnight last night. And we see a little bit of a decrease in the activity going into this morning. When all was said and done, Fort Lauderdale, 25.91 inches of rain, and Hollywood, Florida, 18.16 inches. We head out to the south central U.S. We have an SPC slight risk from Nebraska into northern Oklahoma and fire weather danger in West Texas and eastern New Mexico. The satellite imagery at this time does show some of the tropical moisture flowing up I-35 towards Pauls Valley, Purcell, and Norman, but not very much of it. The rest of the southern plains pretty devoid of low clouds. Now, we do have what looks like maybe some out cumulus castellanus maybe patches of cirrus right there around Alva, and some elevated cumulus starting to get going in the panhandles. So we're looking for cells to start developing, possibly in central Kansas into northwestern Oklahoma in the next few hours. And definitely some evidence of a frontal boundary in southeastern Colorado. This is going to be post-frontal air, some stratus and stratocumulus back there. This is the transition zone where there's been mixing along that frontal zone. And then we hit the front right there. And then down to the south, that's going to be the continental tropical air behind the dry line. And the dry line, probably somewhere in here. The northern plains, under the influence of another Canadian air mass surging southeastward, there's been some snow coming down around Cheyenne and Boulder. A lot of it is rain, though. You can see 40s all the way from western Nebraska up to Fargo and Grand Forks. In the mountains, a little bit of snow, but rain indicated around Grand Junction. And of course, we do have that slight risk I just talked about that extends about as far north as Interstate 80. Now, typically these fronts are not favored for severe weather because you've got cold air that quickly undercuts the storms as they develop. So a lot of the better severe risks are going to be down in Kansas and towards the Oklahoma border. And there's the satellite loop. Looks like some snow on the ground still in North Dakota, but just to the west, cold air advection flowing south around Minot and back towards Miles City. Further south, there's that post-frontal stratus and stratocumulus. And then to the east, around Chicago, Minneapolis, warm weather. And you can see that ranges from 80s all over Michigan, 82 there at Chicago, 82 at Minneapolis, and 80 at Des Moines. So we've definitely shifted seasons here, even seeing 70s and 80s up there in northern Wisconsin. In the southwest, we've got that polar front moving through the Four Corners area, one poorly defined surface system around Grand Junction. Could definitely see some cold air advection through Las Vegas, Kingman, and Page. And further to the south, that's going to be that continental tropical air. The boundary was pretty hard to find around Los Angeles, so I put it right there in the San Gabriel Mountains. Looks like down to the south, the air mass is relatively undisturbed, but up to the north, rather cool temperatures, right around 50 in the San Joaquin Valley. And not very much heat at all in Arizona. Kind of weird that New England is 20 degrees warmer than what we see here. 70s in Phoenix and Tucson, and right around 70 at Las Vegas. In the northwestern U.S., they're under the influence of a Pacific air mass. You can see the thickness contours here in blue, indicating thermal troughing. So that's going to be part of that Pacific air mass that has settled in across the Intermountain region. Temperatures in the 30s and 40s. And here's a look at the Space Needle camera in Seattle this morning, showing overcast stratus. And we head out into the Pacific, high pressure off of California. We're going to be seeing a lot more of that heading into summer because the pressures tend to increase out over the ocean regions going into the warm season. Going up into the Gulf of Alaska, we see an occluded system, 991 millibar low, and that's actually got a little bit of volcanic ash wound up in it. So we look at the multispectral satellite imagery. Mount Shiveluch, which is in Kamchatka at the very top left, that erupted a few days ago, and we've got this red filament that you can see moving through the center of the screen. That's volcanic ash, and you can see it wrapping up into that occlusion in the Gulf of Alaska. So very spectacular there. I thought you would enjoy that. And there's a segment there for aviation for volcanic ash. And that's definitely playing havoc with air traffic out over the Gulf of Alaska. A lot of flights coming from Asia, taking a very southerly track, very unusual. Typically, they run about like this. Otherwise, up in mainland Alaska, it has continued to be cold up there. Minus 20 degrees at Nome this morning, breaking the record of minus 16 set in 1964. And this is this big cold ridge extending from Chukotka into Victoria Island and Nunavut. And along that axis, temperatures well below zero. And then shifting into Canada, yeah, there's a little bit of an information vacuum up there. I don't get much in the way of records and notable events, but I can tell you what I'm seeing here on the charts. Continued cold, temperatures running well below zero across the northern regions, down to minus 12 at Banks Island, and then shifting south to the populated areas, fair weather across the west, and then we go into the prairies, picking up some mixed rain and snow from that system down there in Minnesota. The better moisture is down there in Wisconsin, some of it flowing over the top, and a lot of Manitoba and Saskatchewan under the influence of that cold conveyor belt. Some warm temperatures out to the east around Montreal up to the 60s, but further out in the Maritimes, cold air advection bringing polar air down into Newfoundland and Nova Scotia. Checking in on the upper air patterns, we've got long wave ridging out east, only broken up by this little cutoff low moving out of the southeastern U.S. that's being picked up by the prevailing westerlies, and it will be gone in about a day or two. Long wave troughing out in the western U.S., and that's going to be a very persistent pattern. And if you look even further to the west out there near the Bering Sea, you can see this ridge developing west of Alaska, and that's very strong ridging setting in. And you can see this Rex block extending from north of Hawaii into the Bering Sea region. So that is a firm blocking pattern, and that will kind of tangle up the upper air pattern, especially over the Pacific, and keep things rather stagnant. Here in the lower 48, here's the patterns we're going to be dealing with. The polar front running about like that. You can see the bands of about 4 or 5 thickness lines. These are going to be 1,000 through 700 millibar thickness, and that frontal boundary extends all the way into New England. And of course, we've got that disturbance working out of the southeastern U.S., and those are going to be about the key features there for this afternoon. Going into the evening, we get storms developing in Kansas. There they are right there, spreading into the Topeka and Omaha area. And behind them, the front continues to sag into the Twin Cities, down towards Topeka, and into the Texas Panhandle. By tomorrow morning, the front continues sagging into Oklahoma and northwest Texas, and gradually makes its way to the east. And then we're going to see another round of storms. I did see SPC had an enhanced risk for, I think that was a little further south around Arkansas, so good chance of storms in that area tomorrow. The moisture is flowing north, and we've got this baroclinic energy coming from the west and a strengthening of the upper level flow. So by evening, the NAM model here developing storms in Arkansas. Some of those will be severe, and they will congeal into an MCS towards evening and move into the lower Mississippi River Valley. Behind it, cold air advection coming in from the Corn Belt into Missouri and Arkansas, so some cold weather there. And you can see this thermal trough extending from Minnesota into northwest Arkansas. So conditions here will be cold and blustery. Then going into the weekend, much of the central U.S. looking rather nice. Showers moving into the Midwest region and in parts of the southeastern U.S. And not much to write home about out west, although another Pacific system, probably the same one with that volcanic ash, although I think the ash will be dispersed. That will be moving onto the west coast there, Washington and Oregon, for Sunday. And there it goes, spreading rain showers and snow showers into the Cascades and even further to the east. Then going into the work week, Monday and Monday evening, lots of cold air flowing into Chicago. NAM bringing snow bands from Milwaukee into Chicago and into Indianapolis. So a rather severe turn from what we had today. Not much of the cold air has yet made it into the northeastern U.S., but that cold front will be pushing out into the Atlantic and through much of Florida as well. And the rest of the country looking rather dry. Now, I did want to back this up and show you something notable up there in Ontario, development of sleet, and freezing rain. That's going to be from about Thunder Bay up into the less inhabited areas. Those are mostly tribal regions west of Moosonee. But looks like kind of a prolonged sleet and freezing rain event, focusing on pretty much everywhere north of Lake Superior up to James Bay. And that will be pretty much all weekend going into Monday. And only by Monday does that start letting up. So if you're up in that area or taking the Trans-Canada Highway, definitely check the weather. And I did want to show you the moisture field. This is the 1 kilometer specific humidity, which is basically mixing ratio or pretty much like dew point. So this is going to be about 3,000 feet off the ground. You can see that moisture heading right up Interstate 35, the deeper moisture down around San Antonio. And that's what's feeding that thunderstorm activity that we're expecting in Kansas and Oklahoma this afternoon. So as we go into tomorrow, definitely a veering of the flow, and that tends to reduce the amount of moisture available. So that will be kind of a moderating influence on the severity of storms for tomorrow, but still plenty of moisture available. So by peak heating, it looks about like this. Moisture axis from northeastern Arkansas down into East Texas. So a possibility for storms anywhere along that boundary. And then things will move east into the southeastern U.S. And then for Sunday, most of the problems will be confined to the Carolinas and Georgia. Strong cold air advection coming in the wake, and that will drive a lot of the moisture out into the Gulf, starting to reset the moisture with moisture return in the Rio Grande Valley for Monday. And we'll see the storm chances start to go up once again going into midweek out there in the Great Plains. And then going into the second half of next week, some much richer moisture, 15 grams per kilogram. Haven't really seen that yet this season. So that will feed any possibilities for storms out there in the Great Plains, and that could be a factor going into Thursday and Friday. And we're going to start keeping an eye on the 700 millibar temperatures. That's what this graphic is. We do see 6 to 8 degrees Celsius across the Great Plains for today's storms. And the cap will be a little bit less of a factor tomorrow, probably some removal due to the strong dynamic lift. And then you can see that cold air advection flowing into the Midwest over the weekend and working its way out into the eastern U.S. And then the cap shows up once again around midweek. Now we see values of 8 Celsius in the high plains, so that's going to help reinforce that loaded gun sounding that you probably have seen on soundings and in textbooks. So that's something we're going to be dealing with next week. A little bit too early to talk about the characteristics of that, but what we can see here is that, yeah, the cap is going to be a factor, and you can see the enhanced flow. So the polar front jet is going to be flowing up from the southwestern U.S. into the Great Lakes area, and that will be something that we will be watching for next week's shows. And that's all for this edition of Forecast Lab. Thank you very much for joining us. We'll see you back here on Monday for the supporters and Wednesday for everybody else. I'll leave you with some footage from Greg in San Antonio, taken back on Easter. So enjoy, and we'll see you soon. Bye-bye.